Hey everybody, I'm Rick Beato. On today's Everything Music, it's What Makes This Song Great, episode 89. The band is Korn and the song is Freak on a Leash. Coming up next. Freak on a Leash is from Korn's third studio album entitled Follow the Leader, which was released in 1998. If you look up Korn on Wikipedia, it says, Korn is an American nu metal, that's N-U, band from Bakersfield, California, formed in 1993. The band is notable for pioneering the nu metal genre and bringing it into the mainstream. So if you go to nu metal on Wikipedia, this is a pretty good definition. It says, nu metal is a subgenre of alternative metal that combines elements of heavy metal music with elements of other genres such as hip-hop, alternative rock, funk, industrial, and grunge. It then goes on to say, nu metal rarely features guitar solos. The genre is heavily syncopated and based on guitar riffs. Many nu metal guitarists use 7-string guitars that are tuned down to play a heavier sound. DJs are occasionally featured in nu metal to provide instrumentation such as sampling, turntable scratching, and electronic backgrounds. Vocal styles in nu metal include singing, rapping, screaming, and growling. One of the things I've talked very little about in my channel is nu metal music. I did one What Makes This Song Great about Linkin Park, who was definitely one of the biggest nu metal bands. But I've rarely talked about the genre. And the interesting thing is that as a producer, I'd say about 80% of the bands I worked with were nu metal bands. So I am kind of an expert in the nu metal genre. Well, some of the other things that they don't say that nu metal features, which this particular song, one of the reasons I picked it, is a great example of, is the use of chromatic harmony. You started seeing chromatic harmony happen in grunge with Alice in Chains, okay? If you think of Them Bones, which I featured on What Makes This Song Great. That would be chromatic harmony. It's got all half steps, right? Even the chorus. You see it in that song, you see it in Black Hole Sun, but one thing that grunge has in common that nu metal doesn't is blues. Nu metal is for the most part devoid of blues. Not only in the vocals, but even in the guitar riffs. If I think of a... Pearl Jam, right, Jeremy? That is based on a blues riff, right? If you think of Soundgarden, so many of their songs are based on blues riffs. Alice in Chains may have chromatic harmony in a few of their songs, but their melodies are very blues-based. And then historically, you know, if you think of all the classic bands, they were all based on blues. R&B, psychedelic rock, any rock genre up until nu metal was based in the blues, either in the vocal stylings and the guitar riffs, the guitar solos. Well, so this doesn't have guitar solos, and this doesn't have blues-based pentatonic riffs, and it doesn't have blues melodies. This was a real shift away from traditional rock, and in some ways is closer to 20th century classical music with its heavy use of chromaticism. We're going to talk more about this as we get into the song. Let's check out the intro. So the dissonance or chromaticism in the music is on display right here in the intro. It starts with this on the guitar. It sounds like it's played with harmonics, but it's D, 2, 3, A, E flat. Now there's two dissonant intervals right in here. We have the major seventh between D and E flat, and then we also have that A to E flat tritone. There's also this part that goes like this, that has this in there as well, that's in the keyboard part. Let's listen again. In the bass, we also have this really angular bass part with an emphasis on the tritone. This is the bass player Fieldy's part, solo. Listen. So he begins with the D, A flat, D, right? Tritone, D, A flat, and then And he goes to E flat, up a half step. So it's that half step movement, and then back down. When I think of the bass player Fieldy from Korn, I think of a lot of low end in his sound, almost no mid-range, and a lot of top end. He tends to, and especially in the choruses, play really rhythmically, and the clicking of the bass adds so much rhythmic excitement and intensity to it, intensity to the music. And then the drum part at the intro. That drum sound, to me, is very reminiscent of the early 90s sound of the Chili Peppers, Pearl Jam, Stone Temple Pilots, or Soundgarden, with a high-pitched piccolo snare or the higher-pitched snare drum like that. It was mixed by Brendan O'Brien. Brendan produced all the Pearl Jam records but the first. Stone Temple Pilots mixed Super Unknown. So that sound of grunge, or the drum sound, really carries on into this. It's really a great drum sound. And then we get into the verse and the vocals.
Something takes a part of me. Something lost and never seen.
Let me solo Jonathan Davis's vocals in the verse. Listen.
Something takes a part of me. Something lost and never seen. Every time I start to believe.
So the melody. Really angular. Almost like a spoken word, but there is a melody to it. But once again, it has this real mysterious vibe, really ambiguous with the tonality. And along with what's going on musically, it's very intense. That was a big part of it. There's a big 808 drop, 808 kick drum. When I say 808 drop, that's an 808 kick sample here. That's been pitched down. Boom. This was very common, once again, in the nu metal era, using sounds out of hip-hop, 808 bass drum sounds, things like that. Really, really common. Continuing on. Band comes back in right there. And then.
Something's raped and taken from me, from me. Life's gotta always be messing with me.
The really creepy flange vocal.
I take away all this pain. I try to every night, all in vain.
Break.
In vain. Sometimes I cannot.
So the two guitarists, Head and Monkey, are playing. It sounds like this. Play along with it.
Sometimes I cannot take this place. Sometimes it's my love I can't taste. Sometimes I can't.
Okay, what's cool about this part, you hear that big 10th interval there. It's like a big D major chord. Then I definitely hear that open G string in there, I guess it would be. F. Remember, they're playing on seven strings that are, I think they're tuned down a whole step, so this would be a D chord. So you're going D to E flat with that sus2. And then in the vocal.
Sometimes I cannot take this place.
He's like. Sometimes I cannot take this place. Really a third bass melody. Let me solo the guitar so you can hear what they're doing. Really huge guitar tones. Perfectly in tune. Wide stereo image. Sounds killer. Let's check out David Silveria's drum part during the pre-chorus here. Love the cymbal stuff. Check out the toms. The drums are really great sounding there. Now, I'm a producer, so When I do these episodes, I like to talk about the production. That was Steve Thompson and Toby Wright produced the record. Brendan O'Brien, as I said, mixed the record. And when something is done really well, production in particular, you need to talk about it. It's very important to how the song comes across. Any song, any genre. I am a student of production, so that's why I want to say, check out the guitars and bass together. Let me solo them. Here it is. What's interesting about the guitars and bass is that the bass, as I said, has no mid-range to it. So it has this scooped-out sound, and the guitars just fill in right in the center of that. So you hear the bottom of the bass giving you that low extension, especially when you're tuned down really low. And the guitars with those big thirds in there, they sound massive. Great, great production, great engineering. Okay, next we have the chorus. I want to take it apart for a second, because this is really the Korn sound. What they're doing in this chorus is very reminiscent of their entire style. Let's listen to it first. Okay, obvious thing is the vocal part is doubled, which is very standard for any type of heavy rock music when you have heavy guitars. Something takes a part of me. So you have a double track vocal that helps it jump out of the mix and cut through the heavy guitars. This is what the bass is doing. This is very much a Korn thing. Feel these bass playing here is really like a percussion instrument. The way he smashes the strings against the frets, it creates that rhythmic propulsion to go along with those heavy guitars and creates a really like a pedal tone. If I single out what the guitars are doing, here's the guitars by themselves. Here's the guitars and bass together. It's like you don't even need the drums. The bass is like a drum part in itself. Now, the voicings that they're playing on the guitar, right? Now, once again, we have that seven string, but essentially we have. And then. Chromaticism. We have the A chord with a sus 4 in there. You can hear that ringing out the open string. Then this would be E, F, down to E flat, back to. And we have that tritone there. So you've got all these really angular chord progression that happens there. And in the vocal. He's going, and then he comes in here, root, flat 7, and then 6, to the sharp 11, and then to the sus 4 to 3rd, right? I love that sharp 11 there, it's really, really hip. Then the sus 4 to 3, so a lot of chord tones there, utilizing that dissonance of the sharp 4 against this chord, this E-flat Lydian chord, makes that chorus so melodic. That combined with the bass, and then the bass and drums together sound like this. The phrases in the bass, the first time you have that chicka chicka, and then the second time you have doo, listen. That, along with the drums, creates so much rhythmic tension. And here's the drum solo, listen. Hear that little, it sounds like a kielbasa. right? Those little things like that are in there and you just don't even hear them, but they propel the groove. Your inner ear, your brain senses those things. Even if it can't clearly pick it out, it's in there and it's moving that groove along. In the chorus, there's also a little clean guitar part that helps reinforce the harmony. Here it is. Here it is with the heavy guitars. Those little subtle production things like that really help reinforce that line that's going between chords so that it doesn't sound disjointed. It takes that angular chord progression and then knits it together so it doesn't sound as dissonant as it really is. Because that bass motion is very odd, but it sounds really melodic because of the vocal melody and little things like that. Those are production things that make the song sound more hooky. The other signature part of the song is the bridge, Jonathan Davis's cool vocal part that happens right here. Listen. Totally cool. And then the guitar comes in with this flat 9 interval here. Listen to this. So it's going between a flat 9 interval, 2 octaves apart, so B and C. And there's a little harmonic bit in the middle of it. It would be on the guitar here. Right there, that. Once again, a dissonant. The flat 9 interval is one of the most dissonant intervals you can have. And it's just a tension creator right there. So going from there. And then the bass. And then we have the other half of the bridge. It starts with the go. Totally original vocal style. This is what made Korn, I think, Jonathan Davis's vocals. And the last thing, at the end of the bridge, there's a little transition that goes back into the chorus with a stop time guitar. Listen. Right here. I love that when the guitars go. And then we get to. Right there is definitely a digital whammy pedal that happens. Listen. Please subscribe here to my Everything Music YouTube channel. If you're interested in the Beato book, go to my website at www.rickbeato.com. Follow me on Instagram at rickbeato1. Check out the new Beato ear training method. Go to my beatoeartraining.com. Watch the introduction video. If you want to support the channel even more, think about becoming a member of the Beato Club. Thanks so much for watching.